checking, 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 appears to be alive. That being the case. From the studio in the bonus room above the garage on the north side of Fort Mill, South Carolina, in the shadow of Charlotte, and the foot of Mount Belzoni, this is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And what the heck are we doing a show on Sunday afternoon for? Or it's probably even Sunday morning where you are.
I built the ark. No, it's actually officially this afternoon now. I had to build the ark because we're about to float away.
Yeah, it's...
I don't think we'll have power or internet by the time it actually gets to showtime.
It is danger, Will Robinson, out there in California.
Yeah, we got an alert on my phone briefly ago saying, don't go anywhere. You could die.
Are people paying attention to it, or are the freeways still flooded? Flooded with cars, not water.
I took my daughter to breakfast a little while ago. It was very quiet out there. But it had just started to kind of rain. Actually, that's not true. It just started to rain on when I came back from my walk this morning.
Yeah. Now, the center of things is going to be east of you. It's going to cross San Diego and then head out to the desert to the east. It's big and wide.
The latest update is actually starting to move north-northwest. It's not really spinning like a hurricane anymore. Now it's just kind of like moving up like a blob of rain. Yeah, and it actually looks like, for the most part, that trough of rain is going to go right over us somewhere about between 2 and 8 o'clock tonight.
I'm dialing up my weather radar here.
I can show it to you. I'm going to share it to you.
Well, I'm gonna put on weather radar. This is my weather radar.
Yeah.
And okay, there you are. Oh yeah. Yeah, it's a big blob of rain.
Yeah.
Which is, it's on the west side of the track of what will be a tropical storm.
Yeah. But if you look there at that track, that's nothing's happening there right now. Yeah.
There's nothing.
It's all moved north and west.
Yeah. And you're here on the northwest side someplace.
Yeah, right about where you are, give or take.
Yeah, near Calabasas.
Calabasas, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's big blob of yellow, which is heavy rain is coming your way. You get rain. Rain is not
It's been raining here since 8 o'clock this morning.
Yeah, I mean, you get rain in general.
Yeah.
You're not in the desert.
Oh, it's a different kind of storm. We had, you know, cold winter storm. We had one day, we had 6 inches in a day in, I was like February or March, but it's a different kind of, we'll see. We're going to get thunder and lightning and all that stuff too. Fun.
All right. And is there any ham radio emergency activity taking place that you're aware of?
Maybe.
You are an emergency coordinator guy.
I was told to keep an eye on my phone. Our Aries DEC said they might activate a Skywarn net. But that's kind of TBD, depending on how much. And all we would do is just report in, you know, heavy whatever. And I know the county EOC is open, so the fire department, the ACS amateur radio guys are there. And the DCS, the Sheriff's Department amateur radio guys, they're like at our local station in the radio room, and there's like two other field positions that they're located in because Bell Canyon is a place where they had fire recently and not good communication. So there's somebody there set up to relay. But there's nobody asked anybody to do anything, which is, you know, it's getting to be more and more typical where there's not a whole lot of activation or activity.
We're in standby to standby.
Yeah.
In case things get worse, but we'll see. There's also this thing about being a volunteer, but not necessarily operating a ham radio if you're going through the ICS thing. You know, yes. You'd be a communications guy, but not necessarily on ham radio, but they're looking for hams to do that. Is there also some contention with the employees not wanting a bunch of volunteers coming in and taking over their jobs?
No, they just don't want volunteers around
at all
that aren't trained.
Well, I mean, but you're going through all the serious training.
Yeah. I still think that for the most part, they don't, you know, sheriff's department's kind of changing because the new, and you know, there's 26 different substations across the county. And so different substations have different, you know, management. So our new captain is more ham radio friendly because she realizes that, you know, extra hands means, you know, more availability, more services for them. And so they're putting in camera monitoring systems, and they've given us ability. We have what we call white cars. So it's not a black and white, which is, you know, the sheriff's car here is a black and white. The white car is an all white car with a orange bar on the top instead of blue and amber lights or blue and red lights. And they want hams to use our car to just go out on regular drive arounds just for visibility. And, you know, we don't do anything other than if we see something, you know, you see something, you say something.
Or if you've got a big Motorola handy talkie, you can throw it at them.
Yeah, no, we're not supposed to interact with the general public.
Yeah. You wouldn't want to throw your Bofung at them, though. Fall apart into a million pieces, and they wouldn't feel a thing. I would throw both bofungs
because I don't really care for them. But yeah.
But they wouldn't feel it. First of all, it would bounce off. They wouldn't feel a thing, and then the bofung would break apart into a million pieces.
Right.
But you know, that's not what we're here to talk about.
Actually, you know, I want to show you the weather thing.
Oh yeah, go ahead.
Can I share real quick? Here's a fun picture.
I've got to push some buttons here to make this work.
So I'll play the loop. You tell me when you can see it. You there? Oh no, I'm seeing your screen now.
Yeah. No, in order to get your thing on the air. Oh, I know. That's partly why I just pushed the wrong button.
Okay, here we go.
Now wait a minute.
I'm sharing. That's my face.
Yes, I'm working on it.
Dun dun dun. Wah wah. Bum, 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 bum. There it is. Okay. So this is right now. And if I play, when you get to about the 5 o'clock hour, you can see it looks like fun. So this is kind of what's going on now. And yeah, it's going to slow down for a little bit and a little bit more. Oh, look, it's looking a little bit more exciting there. And that blue dot in the middle, that's me. And that doesn't look so good right there. That's about 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, starting to circle overhead, and then it restarts. So
okay, that is future.
That's the future. So that's like kind of what leads up in 5 o'clock tonight.
Live in the future.
Which is why I think it's very possible and likely I'll be dragging the generator out and plug it in the refrigerator. And
so you do get rain throughout the course of the year off and on, but not a lot.
Not like, yeah, not, you know, they were saying 7 to 10 inches potentially in a short period of time. We can usually handle about an inch or inch and a half an hour, but if it really comes down, then we'll see.
Yeah, and LA has got those dry rivers that
they're all concreted over now.
But I mean, it's still a channel for the water to move through.
You know, honestly, in some places there still are, and a lot of places they're not. You know, I remember being a kid growing up in this neighborhood, this area, and along Topanga Canyon through the valley, there used to be, you know, a concreted, you know, river that ran along both of the malls. That so when you went in the malls, you have to drive over, you know, a little bridge to get there. And those are all now like totally covered over. So,
is there a hole in the bottom for the water to go through, or are they just,
okay. You know, it goes sidewalk to sidewalk in every intersection.
Let's flood the neighborhood.
Yeah.
So, yeah. When I lived out in Lake Havasu City, Arizona, which is also going to get inches of rain that they're not used to. They would have what they call washes or arroyos, basically just a dry culvert, most of the time just dry and dusty. But there'd be a thunderstorm up in the mountains, and an hour later, those things would turn into small raging rivers.
Yep.
But people, this being a town with a lot of new people in it, they wouldn't realize that could happen at any time, but most, you know, in the summertime. They would park their cars in these things because it's a place to park. Right. And then the water would come rushing in and wash their cars down to the Colorado River. I shouldn't laugh.
But they'll drive, or worse, they'll drive across them. You know, that's
well, yeah, because they get deep.
Yeah. Stay alive. Don't drive.
Drive into them and then start, you know, floating down the wash.
Yeah.
Okay. But like I say, that wasn't what we were here
that's
for.
That's not why we're doing this.
No, here's the deal. Because we're not going to do a show because you're going to be floating our way toward the Pacific Ocean.
I've been building the ark.
We're going to do a rerun. Woo-hoo. And this is just an intro for the rerun. So this is 6 years since Jeff, AC4ZO, and Bobby, KD4ZVW, and I, Jeff's now Silent Key, sadly, went out to Wyoming to see the eclipse.
Mm-hmm.
So we called the show something different. We called it Totaled at the time. Today I'm calling it A Little Black Hole in the Sky, because that's what an eclipse looks like when you get to see one with your naked eye staring up at the sun, or at the, you know, where the sun would be blocked by the moon. Don't do it until the eclipse is total, and you got about 2.5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And the little logo icon thing I've got is what they call the diamond ring. That's what you see just before you sear your retina and no longer have sight.
There you go. Just before and just after it's over, right? When it starts and when it ends.
You don't see that before. I don't think you see that before. I think you only see it at the end. Seems like you should see it before.
You should see it on both sides. Yeah,
you should.
And we have some eclipses coming up.
The reason why you don't see it before is you got your thick smoked glasses bright. On. And so you can't see anything until everything goes black, and then you take them off. And as you will see, as you saw if you watched the show the first time 6 years ago, and as you'll see in the rerun, and I just go, I'm speechless. I'm not a spiritual guy, but it's an emotional experience.
Cool. Well, it's a show.
When we finish babbling here, I'll take this part. I'll edit it on there and I'll stick it on. But wait, there's more.
Uh-oh.
A friend of mine, Martin, KA4CFS, does a YouTube show for promoting ham radio to new people. Mm-hmm. And I was answering some questions that he had posted on Facebook about GMRS.
Oh.
And he now thinks we're going X-rated here.
No, it's hot. You know, it's even though it's.
Are you still having your heat wave?
Whatever, it's still 82 degrees.
I was going to ask because you're out in the studio.
Has
it cooled down yet?
It's not.
Yeah, the rain will cool it down a little bit.
No, it's
just not. Raised the humidity to 100%.
It was 50. Well, I was out here. I had a phone call at 6 this morning, and it was 78 and 45% humidity. Now it's 82 and 56% humidity. So
yeah, well, we got another week. In the 90s all week down here, but the studio in the bonus room
is air
studio in the bonus room. Yes, it's well air conditioned. It's like 75 degrees in here right now.
So GMRS, your friend has GMRS.
Yeah. Stuff? So he does a YouTube show, and he and I answered some questions, and he said, well, you know more about GMRS than practically anybody in the world. So would you be on my show? And so we're going to do that tonight at 9 o'clock, and I'll put it. He doesn't do it live. But that's I'll put it live. I'll put it on our channel.
Okay.
So cool. I'll be back again. So you'll get this. You'll get
bonus episodes.
You get the upload of the show with the rerun in it, because you're not going to see the rerun at the end of this unless what you're watching now is this is getting very complicated. Unless what you're watching now is the playback, in which case you will see the rerun play. But if you're watching this live, you will not. And if you're watching a playback of this live recording, you will not.
I'm so confused.
Because there's no way to just tack it on the way YouTube works.
Oh,
It'll be a separate thing. It'll have all this again, and then it'll be the rerun. But they'll be carefully labeled. This says intro, and then it'll just be rerun. And then later on, I probably won't label it at all. It'll just be, you know, me and Martin.
Cool. You have fun with them.
If you haven't recorded it yet,
so you haven't recorded it yet, or you're recording it
With Martin?
Yeah, later.
That's 9 o'clock tonight live.
Oh, okay, got it.
And live on our channel and recorded on his, and whatever he does to finish off his shows. So it's just the conversation part for him. But I said, I'll stick it on my channel live and what the heck. And that way, you know, he's going to get millions more views than he's ever gotten before because he'll pick up our vast audience.
You mean that 12 people that watch us?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many? Do we have some folks watching now? Is there anybody? I can't see anybody. The lights are on. I'm missing a light.
Oh, what happened to my YouTube's not signed in? What the?
What the what?
I didn't say that part. Oh, I hate this. Let's see. I have to go on my phone and I have to open my Gmail app to get them to authenticate that it's really me trying to get on my thing. So you guys are going to talk about GMRS? Are you going to like deep dive in deeper than we dove before?
This is an overview for people that are never evers. So, we just have William K4ARX. He's asking, don't you have an outside camera?
Do I?
Yeah, that's it. And he's the only one watching. Good fun.
I do. You know, I have outside cameras. I have like my Ring doorbell and I have some rings in the driveway, but I don't know how to get that off of my phone onto the computer. But you know, it's boring right now. I could actually, I'll show you. It's boring because it just looks like wet. I mean, honestly, and it's not super wet. Oh, look, here we go. Ham radio now. Let's see. Here is, let's see if I can do it sideways. And I'll go live. And let's see. That's the front.
Oh, that shows up well. It's just wet pavement.
It's just wet. Yeah.
Nobody.
If you could see at the end of the driveway there, if you could see better, let's see if I can zoom it in.
You're never going to be back in focus again. Okay, so you can see a little bit of a trickle.
At the end of the driveway there where the car just drove by,
yeah,
it becomes a rushing torrent of water when it's really raining heavy, such that, what the heck is on my wife's car? That doesn't look good. Oh, yeah, that's the X to close the application. Yeah.
the car that drove by didn't even make a splash, so.
Yeah, well, so there's two lanes there, and if they drive by in the slow lane, then it's all through the water. Like when I drive up there with the FJ and it's raining hard, I drive in the slow lane because it's really easy way to wash the undercarriage of my car. But right now it's not coming down
with acid rain.
Yeah, with acid rain and the other stuff. Let's see, there's one more view I could show you. Here's the front door view.
It's a good thing that
camera's offline.
It's a good thing that the rerun show is only an hour and a half because we're going to boost it up to 2 hours.
Yeah, well, I'm going to, in a little bit, I got to go like go leave and then go walk around the perimeter. Oh, the camera's offline. To see what because I cleared French drains on the west side of the house. That French drain was all full of mud, and I got about 6 inches down the pipe with the snake before I popped it through. And the one on the east side of the house, I couldn't get popped through. I got about six and a half feet down that one before I ran out of snake to go down that hole. And so it's going to back up on that side. So I just got to keep an eye on it.
Okay. Well, cool.
Or wet.
Yes. Wet.
So you guys are going to talk GMRS.
Yeah.
The basics. Rerun.
The basics. And that's it. But I gotta get this done. Because we got to go over and visit mother-in-law.
Okay.
It's been a tough week in health, health-wise here in the family.
Oh, sorry to hear that.
Yeah. I mean, it hasn't been life-threatening, but in a way it was. Some defib with going on with my mother-in-law, which she's 89, and that can get bad. And then Cyndi hasn't been feeling great this week.
Uh-huh. Does she have the COVID or just other stuff?
No, we had the COVID a couple of weeks ago. She's got something else going on. Huh. So that's delicate, and we're not going to talk any more about it.
All right. Well, you know what? All I can say based on what I know is just take the best care of her that you can, because you never know how long you have with her.
Yes. So. Yeah. Yep. Yep. Well, we lost her dad earlier this year, so we know.
Yep.
All right, you guys.
All right, bye to the five people that are watching, which is me and Gary and
here's what we need to do, because I know how the rerun starts. So to get into the rerun, let's have you get into the rerun by saying, Gary, count it down. And again, you're full screen, so go ahead.
Gary, count it down.
5 seconds. 4, 3. This is Ham Radio Now. It is Ham Radio Now. I can prove it. Watch how I prove it. There you go. And the show is, can I do that?
Yep.
Totaled.
343. Holy cow.
Yeah, Ham Radio Now, episode 343, totaled. And I'm Gary Pierce. Oh, wait a minute. I got to push some more buttons here. When am I going to say that? Come on there. Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and to my
and I'm
my left.
Dave. Yeah, there I am. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
And let's see, make that go away. It's the problem of being the host and the technical director. It gets a little confusing. We have here in the studio on the, where did I put your title, Cyndi? I think I put you here. There we go.
Yep.
My lovely wife, Cyndi, KD4ECW. And to her right, screen left, is infrequent, although apparently more and more frequent lately, co-host Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO. All the titles are taken care of, at least for now. And I've got a shot that shows all of us.
Excellent.
That's good.
And we're all here to play Jeopardy. we're here because this big eclipse went by. But before we get to the eclipse, I should mention, if I can find the web thing, we should be doing an MCOM Extra, David, because this hurricane that was supposed to be barely a tropical storm as it hit Texas is now going to be a Category 3.
Yeah, it's going to be a big deal.
Yeah. So, but we're not doing, we're not going to do an MCOM Extra because pretty much don't have time.
You're hitting the road again, right?
Tonight, yeah. Back on the road on Saturday morning. I'm going to be gone for a while. You going to do any shows?
I'm going to try. I had one guy lined up, and I have a second possibility. And who knows, maybe I'll find somebody down in South Texas.
Texas.
See what we can do.
That would be good if you can, because
fill that out.
This show is pretty much Jeff and my trip to Wyoming and Colorado and his wife, Bobby. And we went to Wyoming to see the eclipse, and Cyndi went to South Carolina. Mm-hmm. Before we went, we had sort of teased about the idea that, you know, the reason we went to Wyoming is because it was a better chance of being a clear sky. So we were thinking, well, we would get socked in, and you in South Carolina would have beautiful sunshine. As it turned out, we both did. We all did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we'll take a look at that in a minute. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. There's my Arvin right over my shoulder, and David's Arvin is visible. If you, wait a minute, I forgot half of my job here. if you enjoy the programs, hamradionow.tv is the place to go. You can make a contribution. You can join the Patreon, use PayPal, use a credit card. Send us money so that we can go on more vacations like this. Okay, make that go away. I guess what we'll do is just get right to our video. David, you didn't go anywhere for the eclipse. You went to the parking lot.
I did. I went to Burbank. I went to work. And then I went out to the parking lot. Yeah.
Did a lot of people bail out from there?
You know, sadly, I got invited to a meeting from 10 to 11, and I was just doing a 5-minute presentation. I told them I was going to do my thing and get out because 10:21, I wanted to be there for maximum eclipse. And they went on and on and on. And I didn't go on until about 10:18, and I went through as fast as I could so I could get downstairs. So I didn't get down until about 10:23. And there were probably 40, 50 people. I think there's 800 in our building.
Anybody?
So there are a lot of people out there.
Anybody talk about leaving town?
Nobody that I know of left town that I work with. I have friends and relatives that left town, and the ones that went to Wisconsin, they were clouded out.
Hmm. Wouldn't have been Wisconsin.
Not Wisconsin. Wow. I don't know.
Iowa. Well,
that's where they are now. I mean, it was Missouri. Iowa. They were doing a trip from California across the country. So. Yeah. The last update I saw, they were in Wisconsin, so somewhere in that area.
Okay. Well, let me dial up the video. And the first piece of video that I've got, if I can find it, there we go, is our trip out to Wyoming. And we did a lot of stuff. We went on Friday and we played around a lot. Jeff, you're going to be impressed at the video editing that I've done.
Oh, I love that.
I've condensed basically a 4-day weekend into about 15 minutes worth of video. And let's see, it's going to come up right on top of David's face here. So let's see if I can make that play. So I went to Tampa. Wait a minute. I
didn't go to Tampa.
No, I went to Charlotte. Charlotte was my waypoint, and then on to Denver. And the first thing we did was we visited Pikes Peak. And for those of you that are not familiar with it, that is Pikes Peak right there, middle of the screen. Went all the way up to the summit, 14,000 feet. Jeff, feel free to jump in at any time, but there's not a lot of time.
So far, you're spot on.
Yeah. So there's Pikes Peak.
That's not Pikes Peak.
No, it's not. This is what?
Red Rocks Amphitheater in the Red Rocks State Park.
Just west of Denver. A beautiful amphitheater. Been around for a long time. You said the Beatles played there.
Wow, look at that. That is beautiful.
Look at, these are people exercising. Watch this. Okay, we don't see them jumping up anymore. They're jumping from row to row. So, and the sound you're hearing in the background was a net.
Oh, we've moved down to Boulder now.
Yeah. This is condensed.
This is a kite shop in Boulder.
Now, we're going to go do something very ham radio. We're going to go see Denver Carpet and Flooring. And if you've ever been here, you know I'm kidding, because right over next to it is Ham Radio Outlet. HRN. Let's go check out their store. Never been here. So
you guys
I've
have an
apparently
HRN
been recognized.
Hello.
You think I'm Bob Heil, right?
Nope.
No.
You're Gary.
And I don't even have a sign on.
I watch your show every so often. I do.
I do too. In fact, I like your show a lot. I've been watching
and you
from
even,
day one.
You were even a guest speaker for Ham Nation for a while early on.
Very first few shows, yeah. And all you guys going up to the eclipse?
I'm not. I'd like
seen
to.
It, been there, done it, don't need to see it again.
Whoa, okay. Once in a lifetime experience, and he's seen too many of them already. All right, thank you guys.
So we learned it at HRO that there was a ham fest the next day. So we went to Denver for a ham fest.
And it was Denver's big one.
Yeah.
Okay, I haven't even gotten inside the door, and you said what?
I said, I've never met you, but I watch you all the time.
You know I'm not Bob Heil.
That's right.
but you didn't say you like it. You just say you watch.
Oh, I like it.
Okay. Who are you?
I'm Jim, WA6FIG.
And where the heck are we?
We're at the Denver Radio Club Swap Fest. What are you doing out here?
Something about the sun disappearing.
Oh, yes. Yeah. But you're in the wrong state.
I'm in the right state for Sunday.
Oh, for Sunday, yeah. But not for Monday.
We'll head up there tomorrow. Are you going up there?
No.
Been there, done that?
No.
Not that big a deal?
It's too many people.
We'll see.
My name is Dick Davies. I'm with Denver Aries. I'm the EC. And I appreciate Gary's work.
Jeffy.
Yeah.
What's our immediate next destination?
Whiskey Victor. I don't know what we'll be able to see, but we'll find out.
In theory, it's kind of hard to get in there and see anything, but...
Yeah, it looks like it's surrounded by a chain link fence, but there's a couple of places where we can drive right up to the fence.
We could talk again for a moment.
Okay.
Impressed with how I condensed this, right?
Yeah, that's pretty pretty good.
3 hours worth of video. Attention, Bert, K10YK. This is editing. So, see the fan antenna up there? I couldn't see that in person. Could you see all those wires?
I could see some wires, but I couldn't see that many.
Yeah, and I couldn't see them in the viewfinder. I couldn't see them until I got back and edited, which is why the picture's not that good.
Nice camera.
You probably got really good reception standing next to it.
We didn't in the car.
Couldn't hear anything in the car, and then stepped outside and could. Listening on an ICOM handy talkie with no HF antenna.
We actually thought they had an outage when we were driving up the driveway.
Yeah. I mean, literally sitting this close, could not hear anything inside the car. Okay, I'm going to play their commercial now.
Standards and Technology Time. This is radio station WWB, Fort Collins, Colorado, broadcasting on internationally allocated standard carrier frequencies of 2.5, 5, 10, 15, and 20 megahertz, providing time of day, standard time interval, and other related information.
They're on 25 megahertz now, too. And there's time of day.
It 2:47 a.m., and we are loading up. This is the day. Jeff, are you nervous?
Oh, I was. Not as nervous as
Bobby,
I would have been
nervous?
If we left it.
I'm not talking, it's the video talking.
This is our 3 a.m. traffic.
Sounds just like
there's
himself.
Nobody coming the other direction.
Isn't that amazing?
So what do you think?
If you're talking to me, I think I'm glad we left when we did.
I'm talking to the audience, but you're part of that, so.
Okay. I'm glad we left when we did.
That's the WWV antennas.
Same way as you would expect.
Jeez.
So 3 a.m. traffic. We stopped at Cheyenne to get gas. They said, get gas every place you can. So even though we were like a quarter tank down, we filled up. And then we got off of I-25.
Oh, no, that was the roof of the car.
I thought it was getting light.
An announcement.
A very happy one, too. We are in the path of totality now. We're still about 31 miles from the center of the path, but we're at least in the path.
Okay, so that's why it's so dark, right?
Yeah, that's why it's dark. No, it's dark because we're still a couple hours from sunrise, I think.
The next town and the only little town is Torrington. So we put gas in the car again because everybody said to do it. We thought maybe it'd be really crowded. The gas stations weren't really crowded,
but
the McDonald's 5 a.m. they opened at 5 a.m.
Here we are.
Who would have thought?
Ready for action.
5 o'clock in the morning in the middle of nowhere.
And this is the traffic that we missed because we left early, and now we're leaving Torrington, Wyoming. Sun is now coming up. And this is just kind of an empty state highway. But we'll see some folks parked along the side.
It is. I'll be really glad when this day is over. But, I just pulled out of the house off Yellowstone there, you know, where I live, and waited for six cars to come by. Every single one of them with Colorado plates.
There is a bit of a rivalry between Wyoming and Colorado. I guess they don't like each other very much.
Well, they don't like each other's traffic.
So seeing cars parked on the side and some
free camping, you know,
makeshift campgrounds. And this is where we leave pavement.
Had you planned to go specifically to this spot, or just was the place to go? You saw it.
We actually were invited, sort of invited ourselves, from some folks that saw some of our announcements on QRZ and watched the show and said, we're going to be out there. And they showed us where they were going to be. And we liked their spot better than the spot we had picked. And we said, can we come over? And he said, sure, you'll see him in a minute. So here's some just the beautiful countryside we're going through.
The sun is over the dip there.
Moo.
Notice no fence.
You have to have more emphasis on the ooh.
Moo.
Moo. Yeah. So it's all my kids.
This is coming into the ranch that was hosting the spot we were at. The rancher also set up a public campground here. About 25 cars gathered in. Our spot was a little farther down the road, and that is Frank Hughes, NF9H. He's the fellow that that contacted me and said he was going to be out there and talked to the owner and arranged for us to be there, too. Pretty rough-looking terrain.
Beautiful.
A total eclipse of the mountain.
Some people went up on top of that mountain. We're next to a train track. The trains came by a couple times an hour. And this one time, one going north and one going south. The ones going south are full of coal. The ones going north are full of air. Frank had a drone. There are some horses nearby. That was a really cool drone.
Do you know what brand it was?
DJI. Okay. I can't remember the model, but they got about six models.
Said it was about $1,500. So I just temporarily stuck a filter, but that's the filter that I used on my camera, which you'll see that video from in a bit. Just snipped it out of one of those paper... sunglasses, eclipse glasses. So this is a better look at our campsite. And this is why we went to Wyoming.
The sky was great.
Yeah. We weren't guaranteed this clear blue sky, but we got it. How'd they get that in carry-on?
They drove the Oreos.
But it actually is still that's that campground area just up the road. And I'll show you some of Frank's pictures on his website.
Wow, he's got quite a rig there.
Yeah. We walked up a little hill and got a little more video from a hill nearby. And again, on this that hill across the street, some folks went up to the top of that. Beautiful territory. And there's the horses again. So, yeah, full of coal going south, full of air going north. Somebody uses a lot of coal. That's just pretty.
I believe we're recording. Yeah, we're recording. About a minute away from the very first little edge of the sun being eclipsed. And I'm going to put on my eclipse glasses.
What's that?
And not watch this.
Somebody's alarm went off.
Oh, that was Gary's alarm.
That was to warn me.
Warning.
But I didn't miss it.
You don't want to miss it. There's no rewind on this. Yeah. Well, actually, there is. You'll see it in just a second. There's a rewind.
I see nothing.
That's it.
Jeff says he sees it.
Can't see it yet, just hang on.
This is not going to be fast.
3,000 speed for.
Yeah. So see, it'll come and go.
Yeah.
The arrow's pointing right at it. And you can see just you know, just the edge of that a little bit. I think I'll hold it here. There we go.
We are 10 minutes in. And about an hour and 10 minutes from totality. 20 minutes in, about an hour from totality. There's a train going by, so that's what you're hearing in the background.
Right, I like it with the feel of
that. 30 minutes in, 50 minutes till totality. 40 minutes in. It is 11:15, so 50 minutes in. And 30
that's
minutes
about
to
the slice
totality.
We saw. Maybe a little bigger.
It is 11:25, yeah. So 1 hour in, 20 minutes until totality. And by the way, I'm not going to be looking at this
when we hit totality, I'm going to take the filter off and point the camera at us looking up at the sun. And maybe we will see the shadow as it crosses at 1,500 miles an hour across the field behind us. Maybe. A lot of other people are going to take pictures of the last bit of totality. No one else is going to take a picture of us watching it.
Light's dropping quick now.
11:35.
What do you got?
Hour and 10 minutes in. 10 minutes till totality.
Wow.
And I'm going to go move the camera.
A lot faster than it was.
What are you getting on lux?
19,000.
Down from over 100. 19,000 lux down from over
100,000. When I first measured, it was 115, but it was well into it already at that point.
About 10 minutes to go.
Right now. That is a big.
Okay, let's see if I can figure out what buttons to push here.
You broke something.
No, that was the end of that video.
Oh.
There we go. So that was just getting there. Getting there is half the fun. I guess let's roll right into the video for the eclipse. Yeah. And what this will be is a continuous run. I just started the camera and let it run through the full eclipse and afterwards, and then there's a little bit of interview stuff afterwards. So once again, David, you go full screen. Take advantage of it while you can, because you're about to disappear into another video.
Here.
It's 11:38. Totality is 11:46. Just going to let it go. I've got the exposure fixed, and so as it gets dark, it's going to get dark.
Ah. Oh, I can see the sun's good now because everything is really high cut.
Now, there's a chance that we will actually be able to see the lunar shadow come across that hill and across the field. We'll see. Yeah, I can actually add that we won't see that. Unfortunately.
2 minutes. Darker.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, kind of. Hey.
Jeff.
Yeah. Jeff.
Yeah.
Look this direction. Should be able to see.
Sure enough.
South Carolina was a hit and miss. Some, like where Cyndi was, was good. And other places,
1,500 miles an hour.
Just rained out. I was talking to a fellow on a local repeater who went down to Charleston. And a thunderstorm rolled in just as totality was hitting.
No, the shadow's moving about 1,500 miles an hour.
Yeah. So it's just going to go, whoop.
How is that in meters? Scientist.
I can give you that, too.
Better that I just watch it, not worry about it.
No, it's more. Let's see where it is.
Do not do math in your head.
Yeah.
Oh, I took my shoes off.
Jeff,
can you watch it?
It was
7 minutes.
Casey, go front and grab the
shoulder.
Yeah.
Oh, you're on the wrong dot. Along the line.
45 seconds.
There's no way to tell this on the video, but it is dark. It's not twilight dark. It's just kind of weird dark. It's a dark you never see in any other situation outdoors with the sunshine. The video doesn't look real dark right now.
It's just a sliver right now.
But it will get very dark. In fact, it'll get so dark you can't see hardly anything, and then I'll open the exposure again just so you can see us.
And then it looks like it's daylight, but it's not.
With the exposure fixed, it is fixed, right? Yeah.
exposure set is manual, focus set is infinite manual, and you should see it. Not that I've ever done this before. You should see it get dark.
There goes the drone.
Oh, he's got the drone going. It was too windy for him to fly the drone before, but the wind has died down a lot. Wonder why.
Lux is below 5,000 now.
Somebody's phone was ringing. How is that happening? So your cell phone can probably also measure lux. We have it on a GPS app on our phones. And it measures what the camera sees in terms of light values. You'll see that. We'll show that a little bit later in the interviews. So Frank sent the drone up to a few hundred feet, and he sent the drone up there so that it could catch the shadow moving across the Earth from a higher vantage point. That video is not available yet, unfortunately. And there's an airplane. You can hear it. I don't shoot the video, but you can hear an airplane go overhead. And now stay tuned for me to become a babbling idiot.
We won't make too much of that.
No.
I think you can see it, yeah, you know, how much darker it is now.
Yeah, it looks darker. It may just be my head, but it's looking darker.
I think you can see it really getting dark.
Oh my God, it's so little!
Pardon?
Now, at this point, you can still only look at it with the eclipse glasses. To look at it with your eye, even though it's a tiny sliver, it would be way too bright, and that's where they talk about the eye damage. Jeff kept telling everybody to stay indoors.
I did not. 70 miles, roughly. Quit that.
4500.
Because why take a chance? We heard people say that.
I got a story about the stay indoors. Look at it. It's getting dark.
Fast.
Yeah.
But look at the shadows. I mean, it's getting that dark, but you still have those clear, distinct shadows.
Yeah.
And they're not elongating like they would at sunset.
We're below 1,000 lux now.
Yeah. 33. I'm seeing just a very tiny sliver.
Yeah, a hawk, which is normally nocturnal, headed out to catch the drone, I think, actually.
Go feed him the drone.
There it goes.
Wow.
Now that is darker than it looked to the eye.
15 seconds.
I'm afraid I'm going to have to.
Oh my God!
Here we go.
See it in your glasses reflecting.
Okay, so I opened the exposure to automatic now.
It's attacking.
So now the camera makes it look much brighter than it really was.
There it goes.
But you'll still see it get darker.
Yeah, the shadows disappear. Yeah. Totality. Mm-hmm.
And look at the horizon. Look at the orange horizon up here.
There we go.
It's gone. It is gone.
Oh, my God.
Oh wow. Oh.
Now you understand.
Cannot be prepared for this. You cannot. Oh, my God.
I'm actually kind of proud of that reaction.
Okay, let me show you. This I think I can show you.
Oh, wow, look at that.
It gets better.
All the way down.
You can see a star to the lower left.
Yeah, but that's what it looked like as we were all watching. It was that dark. Yeah, so this is...
Yeah, that star was Regulus, it turned out. Brightest star in Leo.
Yep.
Wow, there's a star right next to the sun and planet.
That's Venus.
Venus is right by the sun?
To the right.
Yeah, we're not seeing Venus, and not seeing anything in this picture because it's stopped down so much.
Yeah, what I'm seeing in the viewfinder now is about what I'm seeing with my eye.
Look the same where you were, Cyndi?
Yeah,
all around
thing.
The perimeter.
You can see the little
flares. This is naked eye. Looking at it, naked eye. All around the perimeter is like red sunset. Let me show you that.
Not the perimeter of the sun, the perimeter of the planet, of the Earth. It's maybe not showing up quite so much here, but it was a very warm sunset-looking picture. And I would like to tell you people that I am burning my 2.5 minutes of looking at eclipse doing that for you, so...
That was nice of you.
Yeah.
I'll never do that again.
All you gotta do is wait 7 years.
Yeah. We're gonna go.
Yep.
Are you gonna go?
Oh, yeah.
Is it gonna be closer to you guys at home, or you're still gonna go somewhere?
Not close enough to us. We still have to go.
Yeah.
Here comes the diamond ring. Can't look anymore.
Yeah, that was the thing that surprised me. As soon as that burst of light came, you had to put your glasses back on again.
Wow, look at that. That is so cool.
Trying to iris down enough, but there's no way.
And it's becoming daylight. Now I'm just looking at the Earth, and it's becoming daylight.
I think you all were able to hear crickets there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that frogs. Was amazing. And we had a rooster that was across the street from us that was starting to crow when it was about 90%.
Oh, jeez. And there's no way.
Yeah, I cried. Your reaction to what, Cyndi? Oh, wow, oh, wow.
I was just jumping up and down and screaming.
We hear people say 97%, 99%, what's the difference? Oh, and why fight the traffic? And it has cooled down a lot.
The difference is... You can't take off the eclipse glasses until totality.
The camera picked up the shadow. 98, 99.
Yeah.
Not worth it.
Well, you saw the difference, the little orange picture in the middle of the screen, and then the totality picture.
Cow patty, even though it's dry.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, yeah. These are the folks that found this site. Tell my TV show who you are.
Oh, Frank Hughes, NF9H.
Casey Corbin, KC9MTL.
And you're from Indiana?
Indianapolis, north side of town.
You just saw your eclipse number...
11. Total eclipse 11.
Total eclipse 11. So you've seen 10 of them before.
Yep.
All across the world.
Correct.
And you've been scouting this one since...
August of 99.
Okay. So if you're from Indiana, it went across the southern tip of Indiana. It went through North Carolina, where I'm from. We came to Wyoming...
clear skies
because of the not a guarantee but
and fewer people.
The best guarantee possible. Not that many people around here. We'll see if there's fewer people when we get 10 miles
it's true.
Down the road.
Might hang out for a while.
So this was your third
second
mm-hmm. Okay,
second total, one annular.
So how does the experience change from one eclipse to another?
It's different.
I could barely talk.
Sure, it's different with the people that are around. That makes a difference. The corona, it's a nice streamers this time. Sometimes it's more symmetrical.
So he gets technical.
Yeah, sorry.
What about you?
I just come along for the ride. I just enjoy watching him enjoy himself.
But when you looked up at that disc.
Oh, it's, there are no words to describe it. It's something that everybody should experience once in their life.
Did it hit you as hard this time as it did the first time?
Yes.
People that think 98% is good enough, no.
99%?
No. It's the difference between dying and almost dying.
Nope. You need to.
Well, you can't look with the naked eye at 99%. I mean, besides eye damage, you just can't see.
Yes.
And again, you see the pictures.
Doesn't do it.
It's
the totality of the surroundings.
Yeah.
You can still see north and south, red sky.
Almost like a sunset on the horizon.
All right. Thank you for inviting
Certainly.
Us to this spot.
I'm glad you came. Good time.
We're on the air. Come over here.
Hey.
So it's just a sliver, but it's light again.
Yeah.
Compared to how dark it was. It wasn't total darkness, not by a long shot.
No. But you could see stars, even stars that were relatively close to the sun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
it was pretty cool.
I mean, when I took the glasses off and looked for the first time at the disc and the corona, all the pictures that I've seen, was not prepared to see that in person.
All those people that were told to watch it on TV sure got shortchanged.
2024.
Nope.
That was
doesn't
so cool.
Yeah. And now, I'm going to the Midwest.
Did you get
I just decided
to,
I'm going to the next one.
Yeah, we're 5 minutes past totality now. 4 or 5 minutes. And it's really something.
Where are you? Where's the sun?
No.
Oh, there it is.
Oh. I can't see close the sun up here. Well, I think the drum's landing.
Yeah.
Drum's landing.
I didn't bring anything that I could make a hole with. You do this and look at the ground.
We were doing this to make a bunch of them a while ago. There you go.
Did you have that program?
So rotate your hands so they can see that the eclipse part is not just bumps in your fingers. No, just rotate them so you can see where the eclipse part is not just bumps in your fingers.
Keep pointing the same way.
Yeah. Okay, so the next part.
See what the Lux is back up to.
We'll be trying to get out of here. And we're going to wait until it's all done before we get on the road. Hearing a little bit on the air, on the repeaters, but not very much. All the people who came up to Wyoming did it over the course of a couple of days. They're all going back now.
Yeah.
And so this is going to be interesting. And this is where radioactivity might get a little bit more of a deal.
They're leaving from down there. I can see them leaving.
They're leaving already.
Yeah.
All right.
The Lux is back up to about 7,000. I say it dropped to below 1,000. It's pretty neat. We've been watching the Lux, the brightness from the sun. It was over 120,000 when we first started, and it was into the eclipse
when we started looking. I mean, it's just on your phone, right?
Yeah, it's just there's an app on the phone that can show it and the brightness.
Here's your camera.
There we go. There's
push it right up.
Let me see. It's that one. It's reading about 1,500, but if I tilt it towards the sun, it'll shoot on up there. Oh, 76.
I tried doing that on my phone. My phone saturates at 10,000. It didn't go above that.
Oh, yeah. When I first looked, we were about 115,000, and at the lowest, it was below 1,000. And it was really strange when the actual sunlight was 1% of what it normally is. I mean, there's shadows, and they're not really long shadows like at night, just shadows, but it's not bright out.
So once again, doing all this stuff and then watching the disc be totally covered through the glasses, it just, went totally black. Because looking through these, you no longer see anything.
Corona, yeah.
Took these off at the safe point to look.
You know, some of the best
I still can't see.
I know. It's pretty overwhelming.
I've never seen one before.
Yeah.
And it was thoroughly overwhelming.
Off. Look up there. You saw the picture as best the video camera could get it.
Yeah.
Just black disc, white flaring corona.
You could get the corona?
I think so. We'll see.
I took the filter off my camera and shot. I haven't looked to see what it did yet.
Yeah. I did some different exposures, and I think I got it pretty well. We'll see. But what you see on the video and what you saw on TV, what you see on the video and what you see on TV doesn't make you go,
yeah.
So what I did.
Did you see the hawk come out? No. About a minute before.
I was watching that thing in the sky.
Oh, well, I was watching as much as I could, but there was a hawk started hunting.
So did you see the shadow? You were looking for a shadow,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Yeah, I could see it when it was on the other side. Could see it when it was on the other side of the hill. I don't know if the hill's in the frame or not.
It was.
But you could see the conical shape of it, and it wasn't a definite enough edge to see it coming across the ground. But you could see it from 10 seconds before until totality.
Yeah.
It was pretty cool.
And I had the camera on manual iris, manual exposure. And when I went looked back at the camera, it was it's too dark to see anything. So.
Oh, good, good. I'm looking forward to seeing the video.
Saw things get dark. So.
Cool.
Right, we'll play it back, and you guys will watch on TV. You've already seen it, but the idea is to get our reaction.
We haven't seen it.
Yeah.
All right. But we will.
Number 11 in the bag.
Number 11 in the bag. Make that go away if I can figure out how. It puts David's face back on there. What'd you think?
I thought it was really cool, and I will confirm it. You know, we hit 64% or something like that, and yeah, there was no wow factor like that. When you put the filter up, you could see it, and it was partially covered. But if you didn't know what was going on, and you didn't know to go up and look at it, you wouldn't know it was even happening in Los Angeles.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm a little worried that we're becoming totality bigots.
Wow. Yeah.
I mean, we had a good time. I mean, it was enough that, like I said, there were 40, 50 people out there, and people brought welding masks, and, I brought overexposed 35 millimeter film, because that's what I remember when I was a kid. That's what we used. And, people had the strainer. I sent you a couple shots. People, had like a kitchen strainer and colanders for like straining pasta. And, there was a sense of community out there, at least.
Yeah, let's take a look at your pictures. This is, looking at it in Los Angeles. And these are sideways.
They're sideways. That was, a pinhole through a piece of aluminum foil. So you can see that there. And that was for my cell phone camera looking up through the that 35 millimeter film. That was probably one of the better ones I got. And that was one of my coworkers had this... It was like a kitchen tool with a bunch of holes in it.
A
whole bunch of little eclipses there.
Yeah, no, it's just like a little hand strainer.
Yeah. And if no one's done this before, those are round holes.
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
They're not half moon holes.
Yep. And there it was kind of falling off the piece.
Yep. So people who saw 95, 97, 98% probably thought what they were looking at was cool.
Yeah.
And I don't want to take that away from them.
People here did.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Keep up on those microphones, guys. Mm-hmm. I don't want to take that away from them because they saw something cool. But there is no way to explain what totality looks like to your eye. Mm-hmm. Again, all the pictures... We've seen them on the magazine covers, as on QST, on TV. You don't get the reaction until you see it with your eyes.
Until you're really there.
Yeah, I've heard a total eclipse described as nature's greatest show, and let there be no doubt, it really is. And there's more difference between 99% and 100% than there is between a 10% eclipse and a 99% eclipse. That last bit really does make a difference. The thing that was most striking to me was the diamond ring. There's a lot of hype about it, a lot of photos online and in magazines about it. And, it's coming out of eclipse, yeah, you can still see the corona and a bit of the surface of the sun. It wasn't that big a deal in the photos, but the photos don't capture just how brilliant that mm-hmm. spot is. You know, the human eye has a dynamic range somewhere in the neighborhood of 6 decades, and a camera has a range of maybe 2.5, 3 at the most. And I guess that's why the photos just don't show the brilliance mm-hmm. of that.
Yeah, you know, that's what hit me is it started to move away and that diamond appeared.
Yeah.
It was like this instantaneous laser beam just being thrown right at you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They say you got 5 seconds to look at it.
I didn't have that long.
I looked about 2.
I couldn't. As soon as it appeared, I had to put my glasses back on. It was so bright.
I think that was Bobby's favorite part, too.
Yeah, Betsy, who was on with us in episode 341 in Oregon, she's in the chat room, and she said in Corvallis they didn't see the diamond ring when it reappeared.
Huh.
I understood that some parts of Oregon by the coast were socked in.
So yeah.
I don't know if theirs was or not. So this is Frank's website. Again, Frank saw his 11th total eclipse, so that's, you know, a lot. Yeah. And yes, and from that big telescope.
The sunspots?
Yeah, I think I've got some. This is Cyndi.
Mom and Dad.
Yeah,
Cyndi hanging out in front of Arby's in Newberry, South Carolina. Yeah.
So your story is you went to South Carolina, and took your chances.
Yeah.
And got lucky. A lot of people didn't
quite
down
lucky.
There.
Yeah. There was your brother, Jeff, had to move twice.
He moved twice
on the coast.
Yep.
To get away from the clouds.
Yeah. And he went back to both places afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
So, what a different experience you must have had versus, you know, Gary and Jeff out in the middle of nowhere.
And I'm at Arby's eating lunch, and then I immediately go across to Sonic for a strawberry milkshake, like 2 minutes after the eclipse. All the employees had come back in.
Did everything kind of stop there?
Yeah. Yeah, it was amazing. You know, everybody that had been at the Arby's took off because there was a some sort of event going on in downtown Newberry, and so we were left all by ourselves with the employees of Arby's and Sonic, and all the employees come streaming out as soon as they hear people. You know, they see how dark it's getting, and everybody came out with their eclipse glasses and just whooped and hollered and jumped up and down and. And it was just amazing. You could hear people up and down the street. There was no traffic on the street. This was in town, and people were coming out of different businesses around us, and you could just hear them up and down the street. Like I said, we had a rooster across the street that started crowing about 10 minutes before totality.
Give us a rendition of you. I'll turn your volume down. Go ahead.
No, I mean, I had to jump. I was jumping up and down going, wow, wow, wow. And whooping and hollering. I don't know. I was just blown away. I just wasn't expecting it.
Yeah. Now people say don't bother trying to take pictures of it.
Yeah.
People will make much better pictures than you can. On the one hand, I shot the video of just, you know, us on the ground. But I think if I hadn't turned the camera around and captured the totality, that I wouldn't have had a total experience on my video.
Right, not on the video, but I mean, I didn't even, well, I started to try, you know, once I'd looked at it for a little while, I got my camera out, but there was no way I was going to get anything decent because I didn't even think about the fact that I really needed to put I don't know, if I'd put the glasses over my camera, it wouldn't have worked anyway. So, yeah, I mean, next time I'll probably just start shooting video, but. This time I just watched.
You know, there's another thing with that, Gary. When people say that there are professionals that will shoot better pictures, that's very true. But there's some satisfaction in them being your pictures.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I guess the deal is you don't want to miss the reality of it by futzing with a camera.
No, you don't have that much time. Yeah. So, only 2 minutes.
Yeah. What I did is I was taking a picture every 15 minutes leading up to totality and then 15 minutes after. And when I took the last one 15 minutes before, I took the filter off then and reset the camera to bracket, a 3-burst bracket of exposure plus and minus, I guess, 0.7 exposure value. and you get what you get, you know. So about 30 seconds into totality, I pointed it up there, shot it twice. So I got six shots at three different exposure levels, and they actually came out pretty good. You can see Regulus, the star that was right by the sun.
Yep.
You can see it.
But, I mean, did you miss watching totality?
Yeah, 15 seconds it took. Okay. To start to finish, that was 15 seconds, and then the camera was put away.
Yeah. Because as I was getting that sunset shot and stuff, and then somebody said, it's almost done. I'm missing it. Get back and watch. And then I did have my eyes on it when the diamond ring came out, which is, you know, the sun peeking over the edge. Mm-hmm. And being protective, I guess, of my vision, I stopped looking really fast. The video you saw stayed going. But I stopped looking. I put my glasses back on.
I think I watched about 2 seconds.
Yeah.
Maybe three, not more than three.
Yep. So let's see. I'm going to go back to Frank's pictures. Let's see if we can get a close-up here. So, yeah, for... people on this show, watching the show, may wonder, you know, where's the ham radio? hasn't been a lot, but those are sunspots there, and another couple of sunspots down here. My camera actually got the sunspots. It's not translating to the video very well, but I could see them. And so he got, you know, a couple of different versions, and then here's his totality, which is, you know, sharper and better than mine. But it's, you know, like somebody else's. So, what you're saying. Okay, I got a little bit more video because, speaking of the ham radio part, you haven't seen very much ham radio because there wasn't very much. I was going to bring the stack of radios. I took I Velcroed two radios together, a DMR radio and an ICOM 880 dual band. And set up two antennas on the car. What a total communication system in the car. I didn't put that in the video.
It was in the video. There was a little bit of it.
There was in the Saturday and Sunday we spent driving around Denver, scanning all the repeaters. There was activity. I'm not saying there wasn't any, but there wasn't as much as I thought there might be. It had the DMR radio, and they've got their own, you know, version of the way they set up DMR repeaters out there. But there were two guys that talked all weekend, and I never heard anybody else.
That's probably why.
and then we were looking for Aries activity, that net that you heard a little bit of in the background when we were at the Red Rocks. That was a sort of a preparedness net, and the guy was asking people what they were going to do for the eclipse, and only a few people checking in were going to go up there. Most other folks, and this was in Denver, which was going to get like 97%, and they're that close, but you know, traffic was going to be a bear. Driving up early in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, there was no activity. We had been told that there would be Aries nets covering the highways and doing stuff, but without a strong sense of mission that anyone was able to describe to me. Once we were there, we were on the fringe of some repeaters and couldn't hear very well. And listening to repeaters was not what we were going to be doing anyway. So I thought on the trip back, maybe that was when things were going to really get more intense. Because as we've said, everybody heading up there came up over the course of 24 to 48 hours. Mm-hmm. Everybody going back left at once.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So it got crowded, and you'll see that in just a moment. So I was thinking, well, maybe that's when the ham radio activity will be, you know, and we got slammed on QRZ.com this happens every time we do an MCOM show, but in this one in particular, well, what are hams going to do? Well,
yeah,
if that shows, first of all, a distinct lack of imagination, because the point is being there with whatever layer of communications we can add. If something happens, we are there. And if something happens and we're not prepared, then we can't help out.
Right.
Cell phones were essentially useless. We were out of cell phone territory where we were, but once we got back into cell phone territory, I tried to call you. Mm-hmm. Didn't work.
I tried to call you too. Yeah.
We had strong signals.
Yeah. You had good signals, but you couldn't get a tone. You couldn't get a dial.
Well, actually, you could dial and it would ring, but we kept getting each other's voicemail.
Yeah.
Did you? Did you guys try texting?
Yes, and that worked.
Texting worked.
Texting worked. Yeah.
Yeah. I couldn't use Google Maps to see traffic because it brought no data in. You did a little better on AT&T than I did on Google Fi.
Yeah, but still, it was just tough getting channels.
Yeah.
Good signal, though. The signal was surprising in a lot of places.
Yeah. So let's go to the last little bit of video here. There we go. It's going to cover you up again here in a moment when I get to play it back. And here we go. We stuck around until the eclipse was totally over. So about another hour and 15 minutes. Those are facilities.
That was toilet seat that clamps onto a 5-gallon bucket.
But here's Torrington again. Remember Torrington with the busy McDonald's, but everything else was quiet? Well,
I think we're good.
These ladies were handing out water and goodies, and we didn't know at that point how bad things were going to be. I got out of the car and walked down and shot some video. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
It was about 3-4 blocks long in town, but it was not moving. I mean, you'd go 15 minutes and nothing moved.
What was on the other end? Did you get to the other end? Is it just...
Well, this... Highway 85 that you're about to see here is the road out of town, and it was not moving. So we bailed out of that. Uh-huh. Go ahead, David.
Yeah, that was most of what I heard when we looked after the fact was people just said that it was gridlock.
Yeah, there's 85 all red.
Yeah.
And heading east towards Scott's Bluff in Nebraska was green, so we followed the green and headed that way, and very pretty, and traffic moving here. Traffic was moving.
Yeah.
South of Scott's Bluff. You can see, if you look carefully, you can see that it's a lot of cars, but it's not sitting still, but that didn't last.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Interstate 80 was diverted onto that. Apparently, Cheyenne, Wyoming was gridlocked, so they didn't want 80 feeding into that. So I think they were diverting the Denver traffic off. About 3/4 of the traffic from Interstate 80 was coming onto that 2-lane road we were on.
Wow. So it would sit still, and then it would move, and it'd sit still and move.
That's a good deal. All right, Jack. We'll catch you a little bit later.
All right.
S7MJ the mobile, working towards the park. That's
the two guys talking about their bursitis, right? All day long.
Big wind farm.
Good place for it.
Yeah.
And there's a cell tower and no usable signal.
Just saturated, probably.
Well, all those cars you see on the road, every one of them had one or two phones going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All these cars. And that's it. That's
wow.
Yeah.
Please store your carry-on bag if you already
have been and place your personal. But you made it. What time was the flight?
Oh, next day.
Yeah, next day. Okay. Mine was 8:00. Jeff's was 6:00.
Okay. Yeah.
We love 6:00.
That was probably good planning.
Okay, we'll get back to us here. That's all the video that I've got, and then that's all the pictures that we've got. So now we just gas.
Well, it was a great adventure.
We punned it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you know, I'm jealous. It looks like you guys had an awesome little adventure.
Yes. No doubt about that. We had been thinking about doing this. You had a countdown clock on your computer, Jeff.
Yeah.
Since when?
About 9. When When I first learned of this eclipse, I bought a countdown timer. It was $25 and a really nice one. And it just puts a little clock in the corner of your computer, like when you're waiting for a movie to come out and they got the little countdown timer. And it was 9 years when I started, 9 years wow. and some months.
And it was 5 years that we've been talking about it, I think.
I think I first mentioned it during 9 years dinners. Ago, and Jim and Denise were going to go with us. And,
oh, you know, okay. We I don't had remember planned that.
Even
that
then
ago.
To
okay.
meet in the. Yeah, because 5 years ago they were on the road. It was before
That's
they
true.
Went on the road.
That's true, yeah.
Yep. So, Cyndi, you made reservations for us.
Almost a year out when there were still rooms available before. Because this really, you didn't hear much about the eclipse until about a month before.
Right.
But, you know, we'd been talking about it for years, and we already mm-hmm. had hotel reservations. We had flights, rental cars, everything. So by the time that it really hit the media and started stirring everybody up,
we were covered.
We were covered, yeah.
Yeah. Now, we booked our rooms at the Denver area.
Right.
Not in Wyoming.
Right. No, because I looked at that, but they had already jacked the prices up a year out. So it was mm-hmm. well over $200, $300 in. So we just, booked
plus,
them
around. Plus we had fun to do in Colorado,
mm-hmm.
which you only saw a little bit of the video of because I edited
there was,
a
There
lot.
Was 2 days.
Yeah. Like 3 hours worth of video.
Here. Oh, mm-hmm. Friday afternoon.
Yeah, it looks like you covered a lot of stuff. You got to go see the clock and the ham fest, and you even got recognized.
Yes. That's the second best thing that happened all weekend. Poor Cyndi.
I know. Every time I hear that, it's like, oh, man, don't do that to him. Then I got to live with him.
Oh.
Yeah, you ooh and all over him for a second, and then I got to live with it for the rest of the day.
I'm a big TV star.
Yeah.
Yep. That was cool. I mean, unprompted, and I did not have a ham radio now badge or anything on, so I know who you are. We're going to go where in 2024?
Well, it hits the very corner of Oklahoma and then across Arkansas pretty good. So my recommendation would be the west side of the Ozarks because the east side is likely to have clouds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll
corner
figure it
of
out.
Oklahoma or I recommend not between Dallas and Tyler, Texas. You won't be able to stir them with a stick in there.
What time of the year is the next one?
April 8th.
It's April 8th, yeah.
April, okay.
So it'll be cooler.
Noonish time. So the sun will be well placed.
Yep.
All right.
Exciting.
We're not set talking that, very much, so countdown. I guess we must.
You got to set that countdown clock going.
It'll be running tomorrow.
Yeah.
The totality is almost identical to what this week's was, to about 2.5 minutes.
Yeah. I'm going to be 74 years old.
Geezer.
Well, maybe Cyndi will just put you up in front of the RV.
There you go. I'll take you in your walker, your wheelchair, and roll you out.
Hey, maybe we should rent an RV for that.
Oh, yeah.
We would have to get the reservation really early because everybody will be running RVs.
Because this eclipse was not in the general public's eye.
Well, there hadn't been one in so long.
Yeah.
Yeah, and plus the last time there was one, there wasn't social media or the internet. So
next one will be a lot more popular. Yeah.
The last time there was one like this, there weren't telephones.
Yeah, good point.
So, but now everyone's thinking about it.
Mm-hmm. So don't forget about it though, because.
No, because the stupid shows like this, they'll keep reminding them.
We'll keep reminding them. Yeah, we'll keep reminding them for a while. I just think back, think about 100 years ago or 150 years ago when something like this happened and you were out on the farm picking carrots or something and all of a sudden it's dark.
Yeah, that had to be scary.
Yeah.
It had to be scary.
Yeah, Bobby's
we've all,
pretty
we've all
in
been
touch
planning
with,
this for months.
With that. With how people would have reacted then.
So when it happened, were the horses still around? How did they deal with it all?
The horses paid no attention to it whatsoever. A hawk came out hunting for like 30 seconds, made one pass around and right back in the tree. The frogs and crickets started chirping up a storm, and the horses paid no attention to it at all.
Didn't care.
We heard lots of weird advice
uh-huh.
that Jeff remembers better than me, but about animals.
Yep. You know,
bring your animals in because they're going to look at the sun.
Oh, please.
Yeah. And Bobby pointed out that the dog's not going to look at the sun. A dog never looks at the sun. That's a stupid human trick.
Yeah.
Right. We heard that they were going to, you know, they could freak out just like they do around 4th of July when there's the noise and they're going to run around and try to escape or something like that. Chip and Dale were safe here.
Our cat they were
in full lockdown. Oh, yeah. So that's what I had the story about lockdown. So my two older ones at the high school, they took all 3,000 kids and put them on the football field, and they had gotten the eclipse glasses. And, you know, they gave them the big stern lecture. You can't look at the sun unless you have the glasses on. And they let them out to see it. But my younger daughter's school, the middle school, they sent a note and basically said the whole school was on total lockdown. And the attorneys at the school district said that that was the best and safest way for them to not be sued.
Well, that's true.
Easy peasy.
Yeah. And so she tried to talk me into taking her to work or letting her stay home or anything so she could see it, but she did not prevail.
One of my sons works for Spectrum Cable TV, and they had instructions. He was in an area where a totality was at about 2:40 in the afternoon, mm-hmm. and they all had instructions, nobody drives your truck between 2 and 3.
Mm-hmm.
So he went home and watched the eclipse, and then went back to work. But there were no Spectrum TV trucks on the road between 2 and 3.
They just didn't want the liability of
because of all the idiots that'll stop in a driving lane and get out and look.
Look, I'm going to stand here in the middle of the freeway and watch the eclipse come through.
It probably happened.
Yeah, well, I'm sure it did.
Yeah.
But
if you think about the gridlock, I'm sure that there were people who were trying to get where, you know,
where
Gary was, right? Or you know, just to a certain spot and, mm-hmm. you know, stuck on the highway when it happens. I guess I'd try to probably pull off the road and look sure at it, did. Not just stop in the middle.
Yeah, I wonder what happened on 25. When we left Fort Collins Monday morning, we had 55 miles or so up Interstate 25 to Cheyenne, Wyoming, and our plan was to leave at 4, and I got spooked, and so we left at 3. We actually rolled at 2:55. Thank you, guys. You were very gracious in getting up to save my sanity.
I woke up at midnight, and I slept fitfully maybe until 1 o'clock. My alarm was set for 1:30 and for 2, and by, you know, 1:15, I just get up.
Well, Bobby got up at 1:15. She said you were up before she was. Yeah. And so we left at about 5:03, and we heard reports later on that by 4 o'clock, Interstate 25 was down to 35 miles an hour.
I would have liked to have seen,
been,
you know,
freaking
Would have liked to have seen the Google Maps and see what was bad where, but couldn't get service. So
yeah, I was able to see because we didn't leave. We were in Charlotte, and so we had about 80 miles to go down to Newberry, South Carolina, and we left about 10:30 in the morning. And we pulled into Newberry by 1:12 or something, which is right when it was starting. And we were delayed a little bit along the way because we did. We had to get off at 77 because it just came to a screeching halt at Rock Hill. And we veered off to the east and took some really back roads. But everybody else was with us. We had a long string of cars, and we ran into about a 20-minute backup. But it was really fun on the way back because, of course, everybody left at the same time. Yeah. You know, once it was over, that was it. And it took 4.5 hours at least to get back. And the funniest thing was that we were in backcountry USA too. And so we're coming back from Newberry, and the first real town that you get to that has any kind of fast food was Chester. And there was a McDonald's, and we actually walked into the McDonald's, and there was a line for the bathrooms.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And we were all there for the same reason. We'd been sitting on the road for 3 hours trying to, you know, just go 25 miles with no restrooms. And so everybody was like, oh, quick, into the McDonald's.
They needed our toilet seat and 5-gallon bucket.
Yep, back
behind. We got that at Bass Pro Shops just for this trip. Carried it in the suitcase on the plane.
I'm okay with just going to a back of a bush somewhere. I don't care.
Well, bushes, we didn't know how many people were going to be around.
That's true.
Bushes were few and far between where we were.
There was enough for
the
guys. For us, it
didn't look like
different.
There were any bushes.
Yeah,
just a little bit.
We had the whole Arby's to ourselves. It was great. Masonic.
We ate well, thanks to Bobby. Well, you saw the package of Oreos. We had lunch meats and you know, cooler full. We picked up everything out there. We picked up the chairs because you know we flew.
And gave them away.
Yeah, picked up three chairs for at Walmart for $10 each. And the cooler, the foam cooler, a Broncos cooler.
Said Denver Broncos on it. Everybody thought we were Broncos fan, or at least from Denver.
and water and. You know, stuff. So
we left a lot of stuff at the hotel and gave a lot of stuff away. But the toilet seat we brought back. we'll need that in 2024.
So, David, first of all, a little disappointed in lack of MCOM.
Yeah.
It was out there. Yeah. You know, I probably heard a couple of percent. I heard communications between EOCs. Mm-hmm. They were on there talking to each other. Again, I didn't get a good, strong sense of mission, and maybe it was unfocused.
It didn't seem like there was that much. There was that one article I think I sent you a link that in Oregon the National Guard came out. They called them out to direct traffic.
Yeah.
But there wasn't much else that I saw, and I went scanning for all the news, and I thought to myself as I walked back upstairs when it was all done, I was like, I didn't even get on my radio.
I heard some folks talking about. What was going on with radio? Our friend Jerry did some PSK-31. He said, and this is a report from Ham Nation, that Ward Silver was on talking about operating on 40 meters and seeing 40 meters as totality approached go from a daytime band to a nighttime band, switching from the West Coast to the East. I haven't paid any attention to any of the HF science and discovery that was going on. So look for that.
Yeah, I listened to a couple of the other podcasts, and there were some folks talking about that. Which one? Oh, the new Ham Radio 360, the outdoor one. He was talking about they set up somewhere out in a field, and I guess their whisper signals, you know, they were set up for whisper, and I don't remember if it was 80 or 40, but they said it jumped from, you know, a couple hundred miles to 800 or 900 miles when they hit totality.
Yeah, so a bigger difference than one might expect. And that is the result of the D-layer. Deionizing. And the D-layer is fast. I didn't think it would be that fast. Well, I guess I didn't know, but it is fast. And apparently it's really fast. And maybe that's some of the discovery that they were doing.
Well, there was definitely a lot of hype. The HamSci, you know, wanted people to go out and run their Whisper and do a bunch of other tests. And, I just got so much going on at work that playing any of those things. It was enough that I got out for 10 or 12 minutes so that I could see the parts that I could see because I didn't want to miss it.
Yeah. But I'm sure there were lots of hams operating the modes that could be scooped up by the sniffers. Mm-hmm. And they'll be analyzing that stuff. Maybe they've analyzed a lot already. I just haven't looked. I mean,
I haven't heard.
I got back and I started editing 3 hours of footage down to 15 minutes. So,
well, that was a great little video. Yeah, absolutely. Yep. Absolutely.
All right. Tonight, I'm going to be, for those of you on Facebook Live, I am going to be on a net. Yeah. Ooh, how exciting. Well, this is going to be a net in Arkansas on DMR. So I got my little MD-380 programmed. I bought a open spot a couple weeks ago. It's a little hotspot thing. So I can get on the Brandmeister network, and this will be the Arkansas Brandmeister talk group, but I was looking to see what the number was and I didn't put it in my display. It just says Arkansas. So I'm listening there now. I haven't heard any traffic. Let me see.
What time does the net start?
It'll be in 45 minutes at 9 o'clock Eastern, 8 o'clock Central. Yeah. When I key up the DMR radio, it thumps the microphone real bad. So I'm going to back off a little bit.
It's still thumping the microphone pretty bad.
KN4AQ, KN4AQ, North Carolina.
Motorboat.
That's a good description.
Oh, 3105.
That's a whole lot of bad motorboating.
Yeah. And what's happening is the transmitter is, cycling on and off because it's the TDMA thing. So at 30 millisecond pulses.
So how are you going to do that? You're just going to away from the microphone?
Well, I won't be on here. Just be talking on the radio.
Got it.
HD.
Got it.
So Brandmeister Talk Group 3105, Arkansas tonight at 9 o'clock. It's, you know, it's on the air, so I've got to limit how much I talk about ham radio now, because this is a business. Have I mentioned that it's a business and that you can do things like send
you did at the beginning.
Yeah.
And you know,
it's here somewhere.
There it is. And love this. Cyndi love this. I'm looking through the chat room. We've got folks from Australia, Shanghai, Oregon, all across the country, Mississippi.
Wow.
So Gary is famous. We got lots of viewers. We hit about 16. We're at about 4 right now.
Okay. Well, we all knew that. Yeah,
three of those are us. So.
What what did you want with this?
Oh, I totally forgot.
What's that for?
I totally forgot. Pick that up again there, Joe. Hamradionaut.tv, C. Arvin, and let me get back off to...
Did TSA want to take that away from you going through security?
No, that is the microphone stand that Jeff went on a scavenger hunt at the beginning of Dayton. We had 4 microphones and 3 stands. And I said, Jeff, would you handle a mission? And he went out to the flea market and found that listed for, what, $13? And you talked him down to 10?
Yeah, something like that. I think. I can't remember the exact amount.
Yep. So I was just sitting here, so I thought, you know, give Jeff credit. We mentioned it, but he wasn't around the show to, you know, to blush and get dimples in his cheeks and stuff.
Yeah. Oh, shucks.
Here we go.
Yep. That's not a scavenger hunt.
Yeah.
Back in the year.
But, you know, that's a good example of what we spend money on here on Ham Radio Now. So did I mention that you can stop by at hamradionow.tv and visit Arvin.
Do you know about the scavenger hunt they used to do at Dayton? It was a contest?
I know I've heard of it. I don't remember any details.
They provided a bare board and a parts list and a soldering station, and you had to go to the flea market and find all the compartments and build the circuit. It was a transceiver. And you had to build the transceiver and put it on the air.
Wow.
And it was a contest, you know, who could get theirs to transmit first.
Yeah, we don't do that anymore.
I guess I had to receive.
Look at all these code-free techs and these kids and stuff. Oh, and speaking of kids, congratulations, Marty. Haven't had Marty back on.
Yeah.
He's been on every other show. But of course, you know, the reason that he won that was the exposure he got here.
When did he win?
Young Ham of the Year.
Newsline
Bill Pasternak Memorial.
Nice.
Young Ham of the Year. So he's probably too big a star to come on Ham Radio Now.
I think he was saving the best for last, because I think if he came on us first, there may be some of the other shows that wouldn't have taken him. So I'm sure he's just waiting for us till the end.
That could be. And things are just, the timing could not be worse for doing something on Ham Radio Now, because I've got this little opportunity to do a show, and then I'm gone for many, many weeks.
I'm going to get one out. It may not be the high production value that our viewers are used to, but I will get a show out.
So get Marty on.
Yeah, maybe I'll do that. Maybe I can get Marty and Sterling on.
That would be cool.
See if they can hop in there.
They have put out a couple of podcasts. So if you haven't been over to Phasing Line, phasingline.com, I think. Phasinglinepodcast.com.
Right.
And they got a show I haven't listened to yet, so I gotta go.
With all your free time.
Well, I'll be sitting on an airplane for 40 hours pretty soon. So.
That's true.
I won't have time.
Will you just put it on your phone and you can listen while you act like you're sleeping?
All right, let's see. Count the number of people here. I got 1, 2, 3, 4. So I will drop out of the equation and see if you guys can manage to handle this on your own. But we begin with, I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and this guy over there is David.
I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
And my lovely wife,
Cyndi, KD4ACW.
And Jeff, AC4ZO. Over.
And
out.
That didn't go good.
We're all looking at each other.
We got it done. I wasn't sure who was going to lead.
I was just going to sit here and wait until somebody did it.
Sounded like you were getting ready to start.
Yeah. No. You had that look on
your face. No, I told you guys.
You didn't know.
I heard that. We can't remember. We forget to remember stuff.
I said it seconds ago. Somebody play back the tape. All right, let's see. Count the number of people here. I got 1, 2, 3, 4. So I will drop out of the equation and see if you guys can manage to handle this on your own.
Should we do it again?
No, that was fine. I can work with that.
All right.
We'll redeem ourselves at another point.
Yeah.
Someday when I'm bored and I want to work on all my editing skills, I might go back through all 342 episodes and grab every over and out and just make a single video.
We have made, I don't think there's, well, there's one or two when I got cute and did something different.
Oh.
So see if you can find them.
Leave those out.
We did something one time, I think. I don't even remember. It's been over a year, I think, since we've done one.
Yeah.
See, you don't even remember.
No, I don't remember. But we did something cute.
I think so.
All right, there's a challenge then.
Yeah, go find them. Yeah. Most people have never seen it. Most people watching the show have never seen it.
Don't get to the end.
Yeah.
Every once in a while.
What do you make of that?
Yeah. We're just saying.
I would be, I'd be more worried about it, except that I realize how many other podcasts and shows that I only get part of because I'm out of time. Got to go do something else. So as much as I would like to think that every Ham Radio Now viewer hangs on to the bitter end, first of all, I can see the YouTube statistics that tell me that's not happening. I can't tell what's going on audio. And I apologize to the audio listeners on this episode because this was a television show. This is a D-. The only thing lower here, I'll show you what a show would be like that got an F from the audio audience. Let me see if I got enough fingers to do this. Okay, the following couple of seconds is an F for the audio audience.
Yeah, fail.
Yeah, that's it.
Miserable.
Yeah, if you can hear breathing in the background, it gets at least a D-. But
yeah, there you
this
go.
Is one you needed pictures for.
Well, and once you put a chart up and you start describing what's on the chart, that's a fail too.
Well,
over here on the left, there's...
Yeah, but if you talk about it enough, you can get an idea. And sometimes, if that's 20% of the content, well, you still get 80% that's worth listening to. Yeah. But this show, this is a television show.
Yeah. And this was an awesome one. Absolutely awesome. I did not get to see the video like you guys showed the video. And that was the feedback from the chat room as well. People hadn't got to see it or it was just awesome for them to see it.
There are a lot of videos out there of the eclipse from people who did a really good job. I've seen a couple of them. They just, because as I look at anything that says eclipse on YouTube, it comes up and shows me other things to listen to or to watch. And I've seen a couple that are very good. So this is more personal, which, makes it special to me. And us. Yeah. But
Well, you were there. You got to see it live and in person. Watching somebody else's video is still cool, but it pales in comparison.
What I liked to see in a couple of the others that I watched were people who also did not just stick their camera at the sun. Yeah. There was one guy who had at least two, maybe three cameras, and I only brought one. So he had one on the sun, and he had one on himself, and one on a crowd around him. And to see everybody else's reaction like that, to do where I get all choked up and Cyndi goes, wow. and all the folks you could see in our video behind us. That is just, no one can contain themselves. Anybody who just goes, that's pretty interesting. They're just dead inside.
Yeah, they are.
Well, there are the people that are interested or not interested. My Monday afternoon, my Facebook feed filled up from all of my friends were here, there, and everywhere, just doing what they were doing, whether, they were here in California and getting the little bit that they got. And I just saw, tons of interesting ways. I would have never thought to bring out a, like a noodle strainer, but they had that. I had a bunch of friends that had, binoculars out, and you turn the binocular backwards and you project that on a board. That was a really cool way to do it. And they said that once you focused it, that was really clear and you could see all the eruptions and ejections and all that stuff. So, people did different things.
I have been in partial eclipses before and gone out and looked at the pinhole. I don't think I've ever had eclipse glasses. That's another thing. I was going to bring the eclipse glasses and put them on here.
We should have done that.
We had good ones.
They're all
they
over
were
the
fit
house.
Overs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. You got some good ones. But I'd never had them before. So all I could do would be, a pinhole kind of thing.
Yeah.
And you know, at 50%, you know, okay, that's cool. That's good for 30 seconds of entertainment and then go back to work or whatever.
Yeah. Well, that's as I went out the door and I realized that, I didn't have my camera. I didn't have the time for that. I thought, okay, somewhere in the office on the bookshelf is my photography notebook from when I was in high school and college. And there's got to be a roll of a film in there that has an exposed strip. And at least because I remember being a kid and we did that. We looked through that strip and I ran back in and I got it and I put it in my pocket and went out to the car to take the kids to school. And the kids were like, what's that? What's film? What's film? Yeah. We used to take pictures on that. Really?
You can still get that processed at Walmart.
Yep. Yep.
Wow.
Yep. Our Costco does it too, but it takes a long time. It's not like they used to do it.
They still make it.
One hour photo.
Yeah. Less and less. All right. Yeah. In true Ham Radio Now style, this is the best part of the episode after the...
it is, yeah. And people are now, they expect it. If we don't do it, we're probably going to get complaints. Because, the show ended eight minutes ago.
Yeah, when we said the over and out, that was the last of it.
Yep.
Yeah.
So, they expect it now.
Yep.
And that's why I started the Facebook early, too, to see the behind the scenes.
It's the over part. Well, there's only four people now, so just one more. All right, you guys have an awesome trip, and nice working with you again, Jeff.
Good to see you.
Good to see you, David. It's been long now.
And I'm looking forward to watching Ham Radio Now. Garryless Ham Radio Now.
We will get something out. I've been playing around. I've actually had a lot of fun, and I'm back and forth between I'm going to try to make OBS work, and then I got Wirecast, the demo going, and we'll figure something out.
Yeah, the demo's
It's watermarked.
It's watermarked on the video, but the audio is even worse.
Yeah. I just want to play around with it to see if I can make it do stuff that I can't make the OBS do. And Gwen was going to help do a show with me, but she got a ton of homework on her first weekend of school, and she's like, oh, no way, I'm too stressed out. So maybe by next weekend it'll have cleared up.
It's good to be retired.
Yeah. Someday I hope so.
Me too.
All right, you guys.
Making everybody jealous.
I hate you all.
Yeah. I'm
not on that note, I'm going to stop the Facebook.
All right.
Goodbye, Facebook.
Bye, all.
And I'm going to stop the recording. Goodbye, hard drive.